Welcome all together. It is time. My project has ended. The Panther A is built, completed and weathered down. Last episode I left you guys with a whitewash that was mapped using washable white. Now I finish off the build using a lot of mud and dirt and dust deposits. First talking about the how and then shifting into talking about the why. At the end of the video there is a section talking about the design changes of the Panther A and what makes an early Panther A an early one. Hope you liked the video. Thanks for watching. Thanks for subscribing. I'm Tank Brusher. Let's get into it. Let's weather the running gear. We go from here to there by starting painting in the detail around the drive sprocket. The toothed ring was painted black and on each road wheel the rim would be polished from the tooth of the track, so I paint this in a good metal. I apply washes after this. I showed this in episode 2 in great detail. No further doing here. That's followed by streaking. That's streaking crime for winter vehicles, I think. The enamel product, of course. And I first apply it, giving it a few seconds to dry, and then I blend it, giving this discoloration effect, not a real streaking, but something was flowing or thrown out of the center from the wheels. Not some dirt grime, whatever you would imagine. It looks good, that's the main importance. Next step is already the dirt effects, or the first step of it, covering about 2/3 of the sloped areas on the road wheels. This is a enamel paint that has a little bit texture and is relatively thick. It's ideal for mixing with other products such as pigments or static grass, etc. But the main importance is here we choose first a light one and then a dark one, and the edges have to be blended. I use a dry brush for this and I stipple the edges so they fade into the non-affected surface a little bit better, and this leaves a quite good impression of mud drying on the wheel, I think. For a compositional choice, I apply more mud the further we go back on the running gear. The second layer of mud is a much darker color from the same product range. I chose this a little bit randomly, to be honest, and I stipple this on, affecting only 1/3 of the width of the sloped area, including the bolts, and I did not go completely round the vehicle. That's fresh mud that has not yet had the time to dry or freeze. And that's the same with the first one. I leave it a little bit to dry and then I stipple it with the brush, blending in the edges, making it a little bit more realistic and less artificially applied. I would like to show the ice glades in a bare metal form, or then the slip glades, whatever they are called. Yeah, I use a soft pastel for this, rubbing it softly over the plastic. It leaves a silverish metallic appearance to the tracks. They look a little bit more finished here. I tried to mix some textured mud using pigments, an enamel product as binder, and some static grass. The paste is then applied into the recesses of the track links, giving it a much more dirty and more textured appearance, blending it in its imaginary environment, I think. And if you wonder why you see only this effect only applied to one track, this has to do with time management. I have to do this as a very, very last step on the other tracks. This leaves me with the final appearance of the running gear, and now let's move on. When we look at this Panther, the only vertical, not obstructed surfaces are the side skirts. This allows us to use some simple techniques for great effect. The surface was chipped and mapped in the last episode, and now I would like to finish them up. Of course, I first moisten them with odorless enamel thinner, and then I apply a dark wash to emphasize the interleaving metal sheets. Of course, I can now apply a streaking effect too. Really good effect without too much effort, and depending on how wet this surface is with odorless thinner, depending on this, it's more easy or more hard to achieve a pleasing streaking effect. Of course, the skirts are subject to mud and dirt accumulating on them. To achieve a visual pleasing effect, I start on the rear with a bright heavy mud color and stipple on some of the mud texture. I would like to get a more heavily dirted up side skirt in the rear than the front, so the front plates only get a little bit of dirt on just on the underside. And of course I have to come back with a dry brush and blend in the harsh borders I created by applying this mud effect. Pulling it a little bit up leaves a really nice effect, and the same has to be repeated once more with a much darker color representing more fresh mud. Again, stippling is the most important thing. And after this effect has dried and we laid over the following effects in the video later on, we get this nice transition that we can see here. The largest portion of this tank is the upper deck, and I would like to weather this in a slightly different fashion. I don't want to go for any more scratches or deteriorated paint. I would like to go for dust and mud and more dirt instead, exploring the possibilities of using dirt deposits for faking shadows and doing the whole thing that we usually would do with some more of oil paints or different enamel products, of course. Therefore, I prepare the surface with earth, and then I come back with a slightly darker mixture of dark wash, earth and some pigments just to create even more texture, making clear that here are earth deposits that managed to accumulate on top of the tank. A lot of infantry was riding on these tanks on the reference pictures I have, at least. And in my daily life, a white, pure white surface is barely able to withstand a four-person dinner without getting stains. Just think of this tank on the Eastern Front with a five-man crew and 10 men sitting on top of it. Nevertheless, this dust or dirt deposit I arrange here is too much here on the right side or on the open areas. There's so much going on with the layered whitewash on top of a field-applied camouflage, the mapping that occurred, the washes. The signature of a dirt deposit is its texture, and with the texture there comes just too much into it. And this is oversaturated by the sprinkling effect I apply now, using again earth and a toothpick with a brush, sprinkling the complete surface. I want to have dirt stains everywhere, but still counteracting a little bit this mapped whitewash. And this is done all around the surface. I use this technique to pull together the skirts and the upper and lower surfaces here. But before I do so, I add some fuel stains or grease stains to set a little bit a texture apart. This one has a gloss texture in contrast to the mud with a flat or grainy texture. A small add-on as a large last touch. I use some brown paper and a selection of some acrylic washes I have laying around, mostly for doing the bases of my tabletop figures. Let me spend a few seconds talking about the working in sections instead of doing step by step by step by step all over the tank. On the positive way, we immediately see results and get an impression of what the whole thing looks like. But if we have something in that it's a little bit overdone, like these dirt deposits on the center engine hatch, we get a problem in balancing them to the turret, balancing them to the side armor. If I had chosen to keep them, I would have to play much more with textures all around the rest of the vehicle, just to set it apart from the rest. It carries too much information. That's because it's a too prominent feature for now. Of course, I can get in and rub them away. This is pigment and some enamel paint. We have a hard surface with the lacquer paint underneath, so I can really get in and spread it out. And once it is removed, it takes more shape of a dirt deposit, of a light dirt deposit. And this fits the bill much better in terms of the overall balance of effects and features that are already present on this tank. I like the result so far with these leaves and the branch attached as a small point of interest, and with the turret put on top of this, the heavy dirt deposits are going away and leading to a more than acceptable result, I think. Okay, just hang on, we are picking up speed. I would like to do the front glaciers next, and you see me sprinkling the surface again, making it a bit darker, almost adding a filter, but in small dot sizes. The most prominent problem I have with this Cimarit coating is its capillary action. I would like to redefine the geometry a little bit more, emphasizing the starting area of the fenders, emphasizing the driver's hatch and the machine gun hatch here. Usually I would use oil paints and fake a shadow around it or apply a little bit emphasized wash just to make this a little bit larger than life and force some contrast. If you have a look at the cleanup process, you will see that the Cimarit immediately soaks and spreads and everything that is really thin right out of the area I apply it to. That's why I choose to do the effects once more with mud instead of oil paints, having pigment and enamel effects mixed, adding a texture. And I'm fine with having more texture on the Cimarit area. The Cimarit itself is already very rough, and just adding a little bit of oil paint would not create the necessary volume to counteract the texture or structure of the Cimarit, of course. We need volume to contrast volume, if this makes sense. Good, I add some splashes. I will talk about this in the next chapter of this video, since this is the effect I use to pull everything together. It's time to finalize the weathering and build process by adding some mud to the underside of the vehicle. The front glaciers here, I use a little bit a U-shape or L-shape for applying the first heavy mud layer, texturing it, and this procedure is the same on the rear as well as on the front glaciers, lower glaciers of course, adding just some heavy mud and stippling so it creates an interesting and realistic looking texture. You might not hear it by my voice, but I have a really good time doing this effect with the heavy mud product range. The thickness of this paint helps a lot getting the dominance over the Cimarit once more. To apply the effect, it's again two layers, and I pull this just down with a dry brush afterwards. And I treat even the first section of the underside of the hull, so you don't see this in the mirror. Okay, the next thing I do here are again splashes with the splashes series from Ammo by Mick, and I would like to break up a little bit the surface, making this overall dirty, splashed, muddy, and this paint I think works quite well for this. The splashes have a little bit more volume than what I do here in this shot. In this shot I basically pull the whole thing together using first splashes for the volume, and then I go to the nature effect using earth, creating some splashes, some small splashes, unifying the whole effect between the modules, since this was not built step by step, of course. The cleanup still works fine using a little bit enamel thinner when we get too much of it. Same is for the turret. I don't think the turret would be subject to much textured mud, so I go for the earth, the nature effect here again, and do the same thing I would do with oil paints, faking the color modulation by just making a little bit a darker underside of the mantlet, splashing the whole thing over and over. The turret roof itself got some streaking effect to get a little bit more discoloration in there, but the whole concept was to have the turret the lightest and brightest piece of the build. One of the finishing touches for this build is adding a little bit a metal effect by using a graphite pen. The ring above the cupola for the anti-aircraft machine gun was surely chipped down to bare metal, and this is a very nice and straightforward technique to add this detail. Around the cupola itself, I place some more dirt and dust deposits using earth, and you can tell by now that I really like this color, this hue, for dealing with the winter whitewash, adding a little bit more fake shadow, definition, some dust deposits, whatever you would imagine, just finishing up the project. And to blend the turret better to the hull is very dirty, and a very clean, just sprinkled turret would look a little bit out of place. So I outline the lower section of the turret using this earth tone almost as a filter, just to create a little bit of a transition between the very clean turret and the dirty deck. And you see this here quite fine, what I mean by this, leading us directly in the last chapter of this video. I would like to use these last minutes to talk about the design changes of the Panther A and what puts this one about in October to December roughly 1933, of course, as a relatively early appearance of a Panther. The complete design changes are very well researched, and there's a good book available about it. If you don't have it, of course, I would like to help you a little bit. When we look at the turret roof of a Panther A, the Lotus periscope, that rectangular shape behind the ventilator and between the cupola, there is a corner, and this corner would be a plate appearing, first covering the hole in the turret, and then it would be replaced for the proper plate for a close defense weapon. The pistol ports on the turret sides would go away, and there are some more decent changes, like the retention bracket for the driver's hatch on the cupola. That's shorter for Daimler-Benz for a few things. Look, this tank was assembled by four companies. There are a lot of subcontractors involved. This is decentralized production, so I can't speak about every feature. But roughly speaking, an early Panther A was from August till December 1933, from January to April 44, we can talk about a mid, and from April to July 44, it would be delayed or last production. If you would like to avoid Simmerit, you can even go for a September production without Simmerit, but this would very much look like a Panther Ausführung D. And this is what I would like to avoid with my build. The front glacis has another dominant feature. This is the hatch for the machine gun. This would be replaced with a ball mount MG gun in the mid version onward. The jack would move vertically in the middle of the exhausts, and the exhaust of the left side would get two cooling pipes. There are two styles of aiming devices, one hole and two holes in the mantlet. I have chosen the little bit later early version. The early is supplied two. Okay, enough showing off and rivet counting. I'm happy with the result, but not yet satisfied, so I keep improving, honing my skills, or better saying, learning them. I would like to thank you guys for watching, for staying here so long, and for subscribing if you haven't done so yet. See you next week.